week travel with Pastor Susan. We will be voting after church. You need to be in this sanctuary to be counted in the quorum and vote. We are looking for people who want to be on consistory, and we are also looking for a new administration assistant, a secretary for in the office. And the mitten tree is up, and you may donate until the end of November. Does anybody have any other announcements? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. less singing and worship is, again, because of the COVID regulations. And so we're trying to honor that and keep everybody safe. And so we're doing less singing. And I thank you for putting up with that. And friends, we gather. We gather in worship and we gather in awe. We also gather in truth. As we come to acknowledge our need for the grace of Christ, we come together not because we must, but because we are open to God's invitation, giving thanks for God's mercy, God's grace, and the power of the Holy Spirit. I invite you to join me in a prayer of confession, acknowledging our need. God, we acknowledge that there are times when we stand in defiance of our need for you. We pretend to have things all under control. We hold our own plans and pride when we are gentle whispers, and we forget. We forget that we are made of stardust. We forget that to be a people of your word means sharing that word throughout your world. God, we acknowledge these things, and we thank you for the hope we find in your grace. Sisters and brothers and siblings in Christ, it is indeed good news that God sees us, God knows us, and continues to embrace us. We rejoice in knowing that God's grace is never ending. Amen and hallelujah.
Thank you. How do you do my mom?
this moment, we take a moment to remember those from our community who have gone to glory this past year. And so I am going to name each person in the line by name, make a time of prayer and silence. And then we will carry these names with us throughout our worship today. So we are going to read the names and remember those whom we knew and loved and walked with us. First name is Terry Ford. Loretta Landis. Trina Del Landis. Corey Marble. Parthena Moser. Kathleen Markle. And Jolene M. Schubert. Naming these names as we come together in worship. And churches all over will be doing the same thing today. It's important to remember those who have died from our community. And this practice is neat and right and salutary if we should do this. And so carry those names and all of the people who have left this world but have had such an impact on your life. Remember them. And tell stories today. Today's a wonderful day to share your stories. So may we all do that in love, in joy, and in hope for our futures. Amen.
Good morning. Our reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he came up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kind of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
While the choir gets in place, this is going to be a familiar song for you. Blessed Assurance, so I do invite you to sing along on the chorus or the refrain. Y'all know those words.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. I don't know about anybody else, but hearing that old and beloved hymn, actually, I think Robin was actually down the corner too. It's a beautiful hymn, and we are assured of our Savior's presence in all things. And what a gift that is, that we are not alone, we are not in this alone, that we come into the church as a community, and we gather, and through that strength and power, that is how we can transform our own lives and help transform our world into a more loving place. Now, the Beatitudes. We probably heard them all our life, right? Yeah? When I was a kid, even a teenager and young adult, the Beatitudes did not make much sense to me. They'd be read in church, and I'd hear them, and I thought, well, that doesn't make a lot of sense. Of course, I wasn't going to always parse everything. But then, I just didn't understand how people that Jesus was naming could be blessed, because they certainly didn't seem to have very happy lives. He was talking to the people who don't usually get spoken to. And so I took me probably into my adulthood reading this passage a lot, probably almost on a yearly basis. It comes up in the lectionary. Often it comes up on All Saints Sunday, and it's often read at funerals. Why is that? Why would we choose this passage to read on these days? I think when we read the Beatitudes, we can read it as a record of something Jesus said to people a long, long time ago. But I read this. I'd like us to try to look at this text. My dad's our ghost, our poltergeist. To look at this as though Jesus is speaking to us now. Right now, releasing. Right now, in our life. Notice not only that Jesus blessed all kinds of people, but he blesses especially the kind of people who are not normally blessed, as I said before. The world typically gives these folks little regard. Just as few notice many of our own silent losses and our grief, Jesus calls us blessed. Jesus tells us we are blessed. And what does it mean to be blessed? Does it mean everything goes your own way? I don't think so. I often think of Abraham. You know, God says to Abraham, leave everything, right? Leave your home, leave your land, leave your family, and venture into the unknown. And God tells Abraham, you will be blessed. Why? Anybody remember? So that you may be a blessing. We are blessed so that we might be a blessing. And when Jesus talks to these people way back then, okay, these folks of little regard, Jesus tells them they are blessed. Not someday you'll be blessed, but you are blessed now. You see, blessing can entail struggle. It can entail hardship. It can entail journeys like Abraham took. And often that is part of the blessing, although sometimes those hardships make it really difficult for us to see how blessed we really are. I'd like to read something for you. It's from one of my very favorite books. It's a short little thing. Rachel Naomi Remen writes a book, My Grandfather's Blessing. She talks about the nature of blessing. In the Jewish tradition, they have blessings for everything. Truly, they do. When you come in the house, when you go out of the house, when you go shopping, when you eat food, pretty much everything you do has a blessing that goes with it. And Rachel comes from the Jewish tradition and was raised by her grandfather. And so she was taught this whole thing of being a blessing, receiving blessing. It was integrated into her life. I don't think we integrate it into our lives quite as well as we might these days, but maybe the Beatitudes is our reminder to remember them. There's a quote by one of the old mystic theologians, Martin Buber, and he says, just to live is holy. Just to be is a blessing. Just to be is a blessing. So take a moment and absorb that. Just to be sitting here today, to be is a blessing. And if Buber is right, what keeps us from receiving life's blessings? wanted us given, or we may have ideas about life that keeps us from experiencing what we already have. Sometimes we become frozen in the past or unaware of the potential of this present moment. We may even come to feel entitled to what has been given to us by grace and think we earned it all by ourselves. Nobody does that. Nobody does that. Nobody does that. We all need the help of God, Spirit, community, others. None of us is an island. And so if we come to feel entitled to what has been given to us by grace, it sets up a wall, doesn't it? It sets up a barrier. Or we might become so caught up in, especially now, in what's missing in the world and all the negative things. You know, we have a big election coming up this week, one of the most contentious elections of history. And I often think, what should I be doing? What can I be doing? Should I be doing something for my faith beliefs? Should I be speaking out more? And especially this week reading this, what I came to is the most important thing I can do right now is to be prayerful, to lift prayers for our leaders, for our country, to lift prayers, sincere prayers, for where we will go as a country, to be prayerful, to remember that all of life is a blessing, to remember that I'm called to be a blessing, and to be a blessing in those small ways that I can do. I'm not going to change the world. My vote isn't going to establish an election, but I will vote. What I can do is that. I can vote peaceably and with dignity. I can be prayerful. And I can be a blessing where I am. And I would like to invite each one of you to remember that you are a blessing, and that blessing is given to you so that you can be a blessing. In the message, this passage is interpreted a little bit differently. I'm going to read you Matthew 5 that Deb just read for us. I'm going to read it to you from the message. Listen to these words. They're a little different. When Jesus saw his ministry drawing huge crowds, he climbed to the top of the hillside. Those who were apprenticed to him, the committed, climbed up with him. Arriving in a quiet place, he sat down and taught. And this is what he said. You are blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God in your life. You are blessed when you feel you've lost what is most dear to you. Because only then can you be embraced by the one most dear. You're blessed when you're content with just who you are. No more, no less. That's the moment you find yourselves proud owners of everything that cannot be bought. To just be comfortable in your own skin and know that you are a beloved child of God. You're blessed when you've worked up a good appetite for God. God is food and drink and the best meal you will ever eat, which we are going to share in just a bit. You're blessed when you care. When you care, at the moment of being careful, you often find yourself cared for. You're blessed when you get inside your world, your mind and heart put right. Then you can see God in the world. You're blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. You're blessed when your commitment to God provokes persecution. The persecution drives you even deeper into God's kingdom. And then he goes on, not only that, but have yourself blessed every time people put you down or throw rocks at you or tell lies. What it means is that the truth is too close for comfortable and you're making others uncomfortable. You can be glad when that happens, even give a cheer, for though they don't like it, God does. And all of heaven applauds. I know that you are in good company. My prophets and my witnesses have always gotten into this kind of trouble. It's the good trouble that John Luther seems to talk about. We have a rich tradition of it. And so we read it that way, and it brings it a little closer to home, doesn't it? that translation. We can say, well, yeah, I've been in those situations and I may not have felt particularly blessed, but when I look back on it, how often does this happen to you? You go through a really hard time, you're struggling, you make it through and you look back and you recognize how difficult it was and you recognize all the blessings that came from it. Anybody ever have that happen? I know I have. You know, in the midst of it, it doesn't feel like a blessing, but then afterwards I can say I learned a lot, or it shifted something and in a good and powerful and transformative way. And so maybe Jesus was simply blessing the ones around him that day who didn't normally receive a blessing, who weren't normally reminded that they were blessed, that they were blessed to be a blessing in the world in whatever way they can be. You see, for these people that Jesus was talking to, otherwise blessings might never be in the cards for them if they weren't taught to look at it and to embrace it. But Jesus is going to tell people, and he's going to help them feel blessed, to embrace that blessing, to know deep in their bones and their soul and their spirit that they are indeed God's children, and that God loves them. Each and every one of us are loved by God. And God sees us, and God cares about us. And when we're in trouble, or when we're not in trouble, whatever circumstances, no matter where we are, no matter how many doubts we might have, or what kind of mistakes we've made, we've all made them, God is always, always with us. So I'm going to share another set. This is from Nadia Boltz Weber, who's a contemporary theologian. Very, very edgy, so these might be a little more edgy. But I want you to think about what she says about Beatitudes, how she translates them. She says, blessed are the agnostics. Blessed are those who doubt, those who aren't sure, those who can still be surprised. Blessed are they who are spiritually impoverished and therefore not so certain about everything that they no longer take in new information. Blessed are those who have nothing to offer. Blessed are the preschoolers who cut in line at communion and bump into you in the hallway. Blessed are the poor in spirit. You are of heaven, and Jesus blesses you. Blessed are they for whom death is not an abstraction. Blessed are they who have buried their loved ones, for whom tears could fill an ocean. Blessed are they who have loved enough to know what loss feels like. Blessed are the mothers of the miscarried. Blessed are they who don't have the luxury of taking things for granted anymore. That could be said of most of us today, I think. Blessed are they who cannot fall apart, because they have to keep it together for everybody else. Reminds me when I read that, when my daughter used to tell me, Mom, only rich people can afford nervous breakdowns. You've got to hold it together. There's a lot of truth in that. Blessed are they who cannot fall apart, because they have to keep it together. Blessed are they who still aren't over it yet. You know these people in your life, you just want to move on, and they're just not getting over it? They are blessed. They are blessed. Blessed are those who mourn. You are of heaven and Jesus blesses you. Blessed are those who no one else noticed. The kids who sit alone at the middle school lunch table. The laundry guys who work at the hospital. The sex workers and the night shift street sweepers. Blessed are the forgotten. Blessed are the closeted. Blessed are the unemployed, the unimpressive, and the underrepresented. Blessed are the teens who have to figure out ways to hide the new cuts on their arms. Blessed are the meek. Friends, you are of heaven, and Jesus blesses you. Blessed are the wrongly accused, the ones who never catch a break, the ones for whom life is hard. For Jesus chose to surround himself with people just like that. Look at his followers. Blessed are those without documentation. Blessed are the ones without expensive lobbyists.
Blessed are the foster kids, the special ed kids, and every other kid who just wants to feel safe and loved. Blessed are those who make terrible business decisions for the sake of people. Blessed are the burned out social workers and the overworked teachers and the pro bono case takers. Blessed are the kind-hearted football players and the fundraising trophy wives. Blessed are the kids who step between the bullies and the weak. Blessed are they who hear that they are forgiven. Blessed is everyone who has ever forgiven me when I did not deserve it. Blessed are the merciful, for they totally get it. We are blessed. You are blessed. You are in heaven. You are made of stardust. And Jesus blesses you. Now I imagine Jesus standing there and blessing us all, because that's our Lord's nature. Because after all, it was what Jesus had all these powers in the universe at his disposal, but he did not consider his equality with God something to be exploited. He came and put on the robes of humility and walked with us as a human being. He came to us in the most vulnerable of ways, as a powerless flesh and blood newborn. As if to say, you may hate your bodies, but I am blessing all of human flesh. You may admire strength and might, but I am blessing all human weakness. You may seek power, but I am blessing vulnerability. This Jesus guy who we follow, cried at the tomb of his friend and turned the other cheek and forgave those who hung him on a cross. Why? Because Jesus was God's beatitude, God's blessing to the weak, and we are all weak, friends. God's blessing to the weak in a world that admires or wants to admire only the strong. The Beatitudes, they are beautifully written, and an important thing for us to keep in our hearts, to remember that all of God's children are blessed, that each one of us is blessed, and we are blessed to be a blessing. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and of earth. This is our God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, God of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and the martyrs, God of our mothers and our fathers, God of our children and all generations. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join in this prayer that Jesus taught his very first followers through song. And he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Know that each time you share it, you are with me, I am with you. And so we come to the table and we remember that story. We remember the gifts that Jesus has given us. We remember who we are in God's, that we are saved, that we are blessed, that we are set free to be people of God in the world. And so, my friends, we will come to the table and all things will be ready. We will be passing out the elements in your pews so you may remain seated, and then we will share together. And so, Holy God, we ask for your blessing upon these elements. We trust in your blessing upon these elements. That as we share them, as we share bread, it comes from your good earth, from wheat and sun and rain. And we share the fruit of the vine, likewise, it comes from your vines and is fed by your sun and your rain and your wind. We share these and we trust in your blessing that as we share them together, we will know you more intimately and that we will remember. We will remember. And so, my friends, come, for all things are ready. The table is set. In the same way, this is the cup of blessing you take and drink. Mm-hmm.
for gathering us together and helping us to remember who you are and who we are. Help us be living bread to return to you as well as our joys and to share your grace in the world. Amen.
Thanks be to God.